Al in Jacksonville, Florida. Hey, Al, what's up?
Yes, good afternoon. Thank you, Tom.
What's on your mind?
I'm a recent recently converted uncritical conservative talk radio listener, and started listening to you and a couple others, and I'm really thankful for the questions that you've caused me to ask about my assumptions that I'd bought into.
Well, thank you, Al.
Yeah, I just finished reading Unequal Protection and What Would Jefferson Do, and I'm real excited to continue my education process.
Thank
I wanted your opinion on something that I think in part reading your material caused me to begin to question the idea of the assumption and of a two-income family being an evil necessity in our lives. And, you know, when you begin to think for just a second about how many familial woes have stemmed from that basic problem, which I have, and most of us, I think, have just assumed, oh, that's just the way things are and the way things have to be.
Yeah, today, for example, right now in the United States, 50% of all children come home to an empty house.
Yeah, it's a travesty, and so much of the things that the you know, the right begins to, I mean, what I used to decry as social evils that were just a part of the corruption of our society, and really, in part, largely stem from some of the socioeconomic factors. I'm beginning to believe that you know that hinge on that two-party, two-income necessity. Would you agree with that, Tom? And can you speak a little bit to that?
Sure. Yeah. We have to go back to the original assumptions of why we have an economy. And this is something that, you know, Americans discussed and were knowledgeable about from the founding of this country right up until the Reagan era. And, you know, when we started stripping civics and civil, you know, social studies out of our classes, and people became economically stupid because they all started paying attention to Arthur Laffer and idiots like that. And the traditional assumption that we had is that a country has an economy. In other words, we pass laws that give limited immunity to people who, if they incorporate, that give tax advantages to people who incorporate, that you know, all sorts of benefits to people who run businesses or start businesses. We do that because there's some social good to us for there to be a vibrant business sector. And that social good is that people can have what historically has been viewed as the American dream, which is the ability to raise your family, put your kids through school, have enough money for retirement, take a vacation every year, have some security in your old age, you know, work a 40-hour week, 50 weeks a year, and you know, you pay your dues, as it were, to society, and society makes sure that your back is covered. And that became unraveled with Reagan when we started entering into this era of social Darwinism. And the result of that is that increasingly, because of this war on the middle class, the war on labor in the United States, and really, if you're reading my books, the book that really talks about this is Screwed, The Undeclared War Against the Middle Class and What We Can Do About It. It lays out step by step how this happened and frankly, what we can do about it. But the structural stuff has been changed. A large part of that was doing away with unions. A lot of that was, you know, stopping the minimum wage from increasing. A lot of that was deregulating businesses in ways. But the bottom line is, we used to think in the United States, if a business is run in a way that, if a business can't be run in such a way that it pays its employees a decent wage so that you can have a single wage earner raise a family, then that business has no right doing business in America. And now the prevailing paradigm is, when you run a business, you have to squeeze as much as you can out of your workers so that the stockholders and the CEOs can make as much money as possible. And, you know, we never viewed business that way in the United States up until the last 30 years, the last 26 years.
And that's, in your opinion, that way of doing business is fully sustainable.
It certainly was for over 200 years. It is in most of the rest of the fully developed world. So, yeah, I believe it is, Al. I really do. And I, as I said, I make a strong case for that in that book, Screwed. Thanks a lot for the call. We got to take a break here. Tom Hartman with you. Excuse me. Broadcasting live from New York City from the mothership here, headquarters of Air America. Jennifer Weary is going to be with us, senior fellow at Demos. Stick around.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.